4 years ago, we started working on Slime 64, a 3D collect-a-thon platformer inspired by retro classics. I've still got the original concept docs here on my drive, and it's honestly a miracle how much of this has stayed true over all this time. In these 4 years, we've gone from rough prototypes to public movement demos through total system rewrites and have finally landed on a shipped and polished vertical slice that is available now for free on Steam for PC, Mac, and Linux. The link is in the description.
We've shown the game at conventions and gotten a ton of great feedback from players of all ages and levels of experience. And we're confident now that we'll be able to deliver something really special.
If you've never made a game before, you might wonder how someone could work on a single game for 4 years and not be done.
If you have made a game before, you may be thinking, you've actually shipped a demo?
Honestly, it all comes down to scope, available talent, and hours in a day. For us, the current Slime team consists of 5 people, none of whom work on the game full time. While over 4 years have passed since the project broke ground, it's not really comparable to what a team or even a single person could do in half that time working 40 hours a week. I'm Wave.
And I'm Jake.
And for this zeroth devlog, join us as we quickly get you up to speed on what spending 4 years of your ever-shortening life working on a project you're passionate about gets you. The first thing we have to do is rewind, past the lovely retro-inspired visuals, the reworked camera, the polished movement, the NPC dialogue systems, all the way back to clicking the new project button in Unity.
When presented with a totally blank project, where do you start?
Trick question. Ideally, before you even press the new project button, you have a plan. Let's give you the high-level summary of Slime 64's plan now, and we'll expand on relevant details later as they come up.
Like we said before, Slime 64 is a 3D collect-a-thon platformer. This means you will explore a variety of mostly open-ended worlds with the goal of collecting all of the trinkets you can find.
The primary collectibles are called Golden Keys, and are our equivalents to Jiggies in Banjo-Kazooie or Power Stars in Mario 64. Our other two collectibles are Bells and Whistles. It's hard to be clever with naming your collectibles in this genre at this point, but I like ours. Bells are most analogous to notes in Banjo-Kazooie. They're designed to act as breadcrumbs to lead the player throughout each world. They shouldn't be particularly hard to find, and should make it easy to understand what areas you have and have not yet visited. Whistles are supposed to be harder to find, but it'll have an audio cue to clue you in that there's something nearby. In the world of Slime 64, there are many different races of slimes across the lands, including water slimes, fire slimes, earth slimes, and air slimes. Our game has a sort of non-standard progression to it. In most games, you might get the jump, then the dash, then the double jump, then the glide. Or, as in many 3D platformers, you may simply start with most of your moveset unlocked up front. In Slime 64, you start by being given access to play as any of the 4 heroes in any order.
Each corner of the world starts the game in some sort of crisis, and a local hero rises up to save the day. When one of these heroes saves their home, they come to learn their local crisis was just a small piece of a much larger scheme, and they set off into the world to find the true culprit.
When both the water and air slimes have solved their crises, a new area unlocks and the two slimes meet. They ultimately fuse, and you now play a whole world with access to both water and air powers simultaneously. On the other side of the world, the fire and earth slimes save their homes, and then set off and ultimately meet each other, leading to a whole world with access to both fire and earth.
Once both of those worlds are completed, for lack of a better word, the two duos ultimately meet up in the capital city and fuse together into the hero slime, with the power to control all 4 elements.
Very original, we know. Hey, put that cease and desist down. Most crucially, Slime 64 will not feature a switch element button. From the very beginning, our plan has been to develop 4 powers that each work on their own, in pairs, and then come together to create a strong, cohesive moveset. It's a tall order, but with time, we've gotten there, which brings us nicely back to... Like most things, the answer to where do you start depends on many factors, but for us, it was clear that the project had to start with the player controller. A 3D platformer that doesn't feel good to move around in isn't a good 3D platformer, no matter the set dressing. So, Jake and I sat down one weekend and basically did a 48-hour game jam.
We established a short list of priorities based on the concept docs of things we wanted to prove. 1. We could get our character moving and feeling good in a 3D environment with both gamepad and keyboard and mouse control. 2. Using assets off of the Unity Asset Store, we could achieve the 64-bit aesthetic. And 3. By making our character's slime stretch and blorp opposite the direction of motion, we could effectively remove the need to do normal 3D animation for our player character.
This last point was extremely important. We'll get back to it. Movement first. We've got all the staples. Jump buffer, coyote time, and a whole bunch of tunable parameters for top movement speed, acceleration, turn rate, and so on. The movement would go on to get tweaked over and over and over again, basically up until now, but bits of the code written in this original game jam are still standing in the project years later. Next, aesthetics. The 64-bit aesthetic differs quite a bit depending on whether you're talking about the Dreamcast, the PS1, or the Nintendo 64. Given the game's name and our strongest influences, we wanted to primarily target the N64 visual style. That said, we also knew we didn't want to be completely beholden to the technical limitations of retro game consoles, and that we wanted to support both crunchified and uncrunchified visuals. Our philosophy on the visual style of the game is that we want it to feel like what you remember classic games looking like in your head, more than being completely accurate to how they really looked. Playing Slime 64 should feel like learning that a long-lost N64 platforming gem was reacquired under mysterious circumstances and given an HD port to modern systems. It should be able to present itself anywhere from an N64 game running on a CRT with a crap frame rate, to feeling like it's being played on an emulator at 60fps with that retro crunchiness intact, or even like a somewhat modern title with cartoony graphics.
To accomplish all of this, we first turned to the Unity Asset Store, and bought what has honestly been a fantastic asset for us, PSX Effects. We've tuned a bunch of it under the hood, and even gone in and tweaked its actual shader code for our own use, but it made for a great starting point. We're able to crank the crunch up or down, depending upon user settings, or completely turn it off for a more modern look. That said, with few textures and no settings, at the very beginning, the project looked like this. It was a start.
Finally, animation. None of us on the team are 3D animators, and so finding ways to work around that intense limitation were going to make or break the entire project. While awesome services like Mixamo exist, 3D animation is so vital to 3D platformers that we were not at all confident we could deliver a polished experience relying solely on them. This approach of making a fancy shader that stretched and morphed the slime as it moved let us lean into our strengths as developers and technical artists while still delivering smooth and seamless gameplay. No matter how the slime moves, its body reacts naturally to the movement. We ended up using some blend trees on some cartoony eyes, added some eyebrows, and suddenly the character came to life.
The credit for all of this belongs to another team member of ours, Richard. He's our shader wizard. He has developed a ton of lovely shaders for the project over its lifecycle, but the first and arguably most important one was this, the slime shader.
48 hours in, and here it is. Obviously, quite a far ways off from where we are today, but there's a surprising amount here. A lot of the jumping feels really stiff right now, mainly because at this time, we were setting your vertical speed to zero when you released the jump button early, instead of setting it to some fraction of itself. Now, instead, we set it to 2/3 of its original strength. This results in it feeling looser while still providing a good deal of control.
Another thing contributing to this stiff feeling is the camera, which, at its starting point, was just the standard Cinemachine camera. Funny thing was that when we first added it, we experienced some strange jittery behavior as we moved around. We Googled this issue and found the solution to be setting the Cinemachine Brain's update mode to fixed update. Phew! Sure glad that was an easy fix with no important ramification.
Remember this, it'll come up later. All in all, this initial game jam stage of the game was hectic, but really successful. Focusing on our player controller helped us build a solid foundation that would provide a strong direction in the years to come.
With the basic foundation set, what was next? Well, everything else. Moving and jumping around a sandbox test room is great, but there's a lot more you need to build a real video game. Our first step was to break down the different aspects of the game into discrete features, and to then create a list of tasks that would be needed to design, implement, and test each of those features. We leveraged a site called Hack and Plan for this, which we still use to this day. It's a game dev-focused board similar to things like Jira or Trello.
The first order of business were the four elemental powers. These have undergone many revisions over the years, but their core concepts haven't changed very much. Here are the plans for each of them.
Water. A boost forwards with tank control steering, along the lines of the turbo nozzle from Super Mario Sunshine.
Earth, the ability to turn into a solid boulder that controls more like a marble in a marble game. It has the ability to build up speed at the cost of control.
Air, the power to glide, slowing the player's descent, and the power to ascend upwards for a limited time.
Fire. Okay, so the fire ability was originally inspired by this really cool 2D platformer our friends made for a game jam called Go Up, where you double jump by laying this egg and then landing on it, and the angle you land on it determines the angle you get sent. And we tried this, but it ultimately felt horrible in 3D. Then we tried a solution with this large disc, but you had to slow down to get the full jump, which also felt bad, and then for a while we had the solution where you spawned a fireball under you, and then as long as you held jump, it followed you and would detonate when you landed on it, but players found that unintuitive as they kind of had to hold jump, and then fire felt awful to move around as because they had no way to build lateral speed.
Here's where we landed! Fire gives you a double jump and a dash. You can use each of these once per airtime before needing to land again. After all that iteration, we ended up with a really snappy feeling power that feels almost like a 3D version of Celeste or something.
With plans for the movement abilities underway, we planned out other systems we'd need. NPCs, dialogue, room transitions, the collectibles themselves, a title screen, the camera, better input support, level design, interactable objects, and many, many more. I want to pick up the pace in this recap a bit, so let's jump straight ahead to our first milestone build, what you might call a pre-pre-alpha build, in June of 2020. Now that's some progress! We've got a title screen, a pause screen, and oh, a map! Due to the structure of our currently published vertical slice, we still haven't made a new version of this map yet. You can see we've got the four corners of the world representing each of the elemental villages, and even an area where you can try all four powers.
Playing this build now, it's astonishing both how much was done, but how far we had left to go. The camera still feels super stilted, parts of the movement are stiff, the powers don't actually work together all that well, and it was very clear that our level design could use quite a bit of... love. Still, under a year in, we've made a ton of progress. We've got saving, dialogue, level transitions, early versions of all four powers. We're on a roll! I wonder what's next for the-
Look, you know what happened in early 2020. Everyone had a lot of life stuff going on. Members of our team had just graduated college, and there was a lot of uncertainty going around in general. I personally went on a whole little tangent where I made a cool online marble game and stuff, but all in all, progress on Slime completely halted for at least 6 months. Frankly, until the winter. When we finally got back into the swing of things, our plan was to assemble what we had, clean a few things up, and put together a standalone demo that we could get into people's hands and get feedback from them. We still had the level design problem to tackle, and we took our first stab at it using a Unity asset called Polaris. It's a terrain system that's more triangle-y. We hoped it would help us build terrains that felt more N64-y. Not to spoil it, but we view this experiment as a failure in hindsight. It was slow to work with, introduced a bunch of problems with our movement, and ultimately didn't look all that good with what we were going for. I imagine for other use cases it's a great asset, but in the long run it wasn't a good fit for Slime.
All that said, we trucked along with it and built four levels, one for each power, and a hub area connecting them. With our shiny new demo in hand, we paid Valve the $100 developer fee, set up our own Steam page, and uploaded the demo.
All in all, it went well. In reading back these responses we got to our feedback form, I think people were erring on the side of being a little too nice to us. Playing this version of the game now feels awful to me, but it's very possible I'm extremely biased. Over 50 people filled out our detailed feedback survey, and those notes, plus more detailed notes from friends, helped shape our next steps. With all that great feedback under our belts, it was time for another... With that push for a Steam demo done, a lot of life stuff came up for everyone on the team, and work on the game slowed to a crawl again. There was a short stretch where I came back and began polishing the abilities to work better together and tweaked them based on feedback, but unfortunately never got it far enough to actually update that particular demo. Whoops. Though something else very interesting happened during this hiatus. It was around this time that I got a high refresh rate monitor and set it up properly. If you've never used a monitor higher than 60Hz, I was surprised how much of a difference it actually made for me. It's certainly not the kind of thing where I'm all, oh, I'll never touch a 60Hz display again, but I found it really did make a lot of things feel much smoother. So, imagine my surprise when I fire up Slime 64 on my cool new monitor and I see it's running at what feels like a super low frame rate. I run all sorts of profiling and everything's telling me it's running at a rock solid 170Hz, but I have working eyeballs and it felt totally off. I went back to the 60Hz monitor and actually noticed that it even felt off there. I tried playing other games I knew ran smoothly and then immediately switched back to Slime and it just felt bad? The frame rate was off somehow, but nothing was reporting any kind of slowdown. And every form of testing I could find told me the game was running great. What? It turns out I was running into an issue that Unity just sets you up for, unknowingly. This is something I now keep my eye out for, and I see it everywhere in games that feel like Unity games. If you yourself are making a game in Unity, please pay attention to this next part.
Remember back at the very start when we found that we were experiencing strange jittery behavior with our character that we fixed by changing the camera's update to fixed update? Little did we know at the time, but we had just inadvertently locked the effective frame rate of Slime 64 to 50 frames per second for the next 2 years.
I hope to make a longer video about this specifically, so I'll try to keep the explanation brief here. Because our slime is a rigid body, it is a physics object that only updates its position, rotation, etc. during the physics step, also called the fixed update step. You could draw a frame 1,000 times, but if your camera is physically attached to your physics object, it will draw in the same exact place, not moving, every time until the next physics step happens and the character actually moves. For some unknowable reason, Unity's default physics time step is 0.02, or 50 updates per second. People have asked Unity employees why this is, and nobody seems to know anymore? Unity has been around since like the early 2000s, and was first made in Europe where the PAL default refresh rate was 50Hz, is my only guess as to why on earth this could have happened, but the problem here is that no matter what we did, the game was effectively running at 50fps. It's amazing the sort of thing the human brain can just sort of tune out, because I swear, until it was made super obvious by my high refresh rate monitor, I had no idea this was happening. As far as I can tell, there are two real solutions to this problem. The first is to completely decouple the visual and physics representations of your character. This way, you can have the visual representation of your character smoothly move towards the physics representation each visual frame, creating the illusion of smooth motion. The other is to change how often the physics step occurs. This is where many developers, reasonably so, throw up their hands and lock their game to a set frame rate, usually 60. Honestly, for most people, I'd say that's great. No matter what you're making, I think all Unity projects should start by going into the project settings,
time,
and changing the physics step to 1 over 60 instead of 0.02. It's a crime that this isn't just the default, but that's one way you can at least make the general case of your game work pretty well. We were 2 years into development, and fully decoupling the visual and physics representations of our character was going to be a ton of work, so we opted not to do that. We went with the second option, but with a twist. Our solution is deviously simple. We simply take the target visual frame rate and set our physics step to match at runtime. If you're targeting 60 FPS, we make the physics step 60 FPS. If you're on 144, we set it to 144. It took a bit of care to ensure all physics operations we control are being properly scaled by the physics delta time, but we were doing that in most cases anyway, and so we've been able to make our game work basically the same at any physics step. The one exception to this is that the physics step will not go lower than 60 FPS. If you set the game to a cinematic, crunchy 30 FPS, we actually still keep the physics step at 60 FPS, as we found some unpleasant behavior going lower than that.
With that fix aside, the project went back into hibernation again, for even longer this time, all the way until summer of 2022.
At this point, we had a problem. The game was going nowhere, and every time we tried to pick it back up, we ran into one of a few different brutal design challenges. Our tools for building levels were slow to use, and even more inconvenient to tweak and update as we got feedback on a level. We didn't have many tools for building scenarios to receive collectibles. All we could really do was place keys in hard-to-reach places. And, frankly, the game just didn't feel as polished as we wanted it to. Movement still felt stiff, the camera still felt awful, and we just weren't hitting our visual goals at all. Look at those awful stretched textures. Yeesh.
It was at this point where we decided to pump the brakes. No new content, and pretty much all existing content was potentially on the chopping block. We needed to figure out a pipeline that would let us hit our goals at a reasonable pace, or this game would never get finished. We reviewed the problems we were having and set a rule for ourselves. No new content for the final game would get built until we had found the solutions to 1. Making the powers work better together. 2. Making the camera feel smooth. 3. An interactable system that would let us easily design objectives to get collectibles. And 4. A faster, easier, and better looking level design pipeline. Stage 6 may as well be called Stage 2, Foundations, again. But it showed how much we had missed in our first go around. This approach ended up really helping, and development has continued steadily since we started. So, how did we solve all these problems? Let's tackle them one at a time. I'll let Adam take this part since it's his bread and butter.
Power synergy was a continuous effort throughout this entire period, but it came down to identifying those stiff moments by watching playtests and recordings of others playing our game and making changes to smooth them over. This was the period where several of our powers were considerably overhauled, and some changes were even made to our core movement system to give a better sense of both control and momentum. Since I hope to make a whole video about this topic, I'll just give you a few examples here. As mentioned before in that fast rant, this period saw us move on from the fire disc to the fireball that followed the player, ultimately landing on the double jump and fire dash. Using water and rock at the same time used to give rock the priority, where the direction water was moving was effectively locked in until rock was released. This was learnable, but not a single person who ever played the game found this intuitive even a little bit. This change suddenly saw players who had previously struggled with using all four powers suddenly able to schmoove at high speeds with little issue. Up until now, we had a shared mana resource limiting the use of water and air. It recharged reasonably quickly, but then I replayed Ukulele and was reminded that standing still while waiting for your mobility option to recharge is a really unfun game mechanic in games all about exploration. Water was given unlimited use, and instead of touching the water refilling your mana instantly, using water while in a body of water makes you go even faster as a motivator to stick to waterways as a water slime. Air hover was given a soft cap, where the hover gets less effective the longer you hold it, using a timer that instantly resets the moment you touch the ground, and the mana system was left the exclusive domain of the air updraft, where it limits how high you can go with air. It also instantly recharges to full the moment you touch the ground, and so, effectively all moments where you were left powerless because your resource ran out were removed. This change contributed massively to removing the stiff start and stop feeling the game had previously. With those and many other changes to the powers done, next up was the camera. Gosh, okay, this is another topic I want to do a whole video about, but I'll give you the short version here. So, often when you watch these sorts of devlogs or game development tutorials on 3D games, they'll get to the part where they make the camera and the person will go, "Yep, so I installed Unity's amazing camera package called Cinemachine, and I put it on my character with some modules and settings and it all worked great and it was perfect." And then they move on with their life. That has not been my experience. Cameras are already such important, often problematic parts of 3D platformers that I knew I wanted to get ours right. I watched all sorts of technical videos and GDC talks, including this awesome one from the person who worked on the camera in Journey. Early on in his video, he mentions a textbook he highly recommends on the subject from the guy who made the camera systems for the Metroid Prime series, so I bought the book. I also spent a lot of time playing all sorts of 3D platformers, paying extremely close attention to how the camera in those games worked. How they were handling cases that I was having trouble with. How they were following the character's movement in different scenarios. I hope to go over all of that in a future video, but all I'll say right now is that it took multiple total rewrites of our entire camera system and a lot of fighting and pleading with Cinemachine, but we now have a 3D platformer camera with a ton of player-facing options that has solid keyboard and mouse support, gamepad support, frames the direction of player motion, can be externally controlled, you name it. Hundreds of hours of my life I'll never get back later, that's one more box ticked. Next up, what I call our interactables system. Up until this point, we were basically writing bespoke code for every unique interaction in our game, which was quickly shaping up to be an unmaintainable nightmare. Let's look at two scenarios. First, there's a cage over a key, with arrows pointing to four corners of the map, each of which has an unlit torch. You light all four torches, and the cage disappears, enabling access to the key. Second, there are four pegs arranged suspiciously. You slam the pegs with rock, and a switch rises from the ground. Earlier on, we might have built two different scripts, a torch cage controller and a peg switch controller. This isn't a great way of doing things, as bugs in one of these might cause hard-to-diagnose issues down the line, or if you want to change how torches behave, you might find yourself needing to change several dependent scripts. Instead, meet the wonders of Unity events. Unity events allow objects to send arbitrary signals to different objects throughout a level. You can reuse the same basic logical objects and have them pass the relevant signals around as necessary. We built an event accumulator that can be told to increment or decrement and to send a signal when its target value is reached. Hook up the four torches or the pegs to increment their own accumulator, and when the accumulator reaches its target value, it can send a signal to a door, cage, or anything. This approach seriously revolutionized our workflow. More about this can be found in Mark Brown's excellent developing series, where he talks about this exact thing. Have you ever heard of a white box? In the industry, white boxing is the process of blocking out the layout of a level before it goes to art to be prettied up into the final version the player actually sees. This approach is efficient, as playtesting can be done on the blockout version of the level much earlier to find issues or parts of the level that need to be changed, and since the level is just made out of easy-to-manipulate blocks, it takes very little time to rearrange the layout. If the level was already full of high-fidelity art before any testing, changes to the level would be brutal. For us, a team of people with not much art bandwidth, we made it our goal to reduce the gap between the white box version of our levels and the final versions of our levels as much as possible, while still achieving an appealing style. We looked at all sorts of examples for this, but one game that really stood out to us was actually Mario 3D World. Look at that level geometry. Simple, rounded shapes, soft-looking textures, and background visuals. This was something we could actually achieve. The fundamental building blocks to achieving this style for us were what we call procedural shapes and splines. We're on a version of Unity from before they implemented their spline package, so we ended up getting a spline asset from the asset store. It's got its issues, but we've done a lot of our own work on it, and it'd be hard to change now. Splines let us make all sorts of fluid shapes and paths. We've got regular path splines, water splines, metal grate splines, and more. For procedural shapes, our technical wizard Richard built the procedural cylinder and procedural cube. For each, we can specify a bevel radius, the number of discrete slices that make up the bevel, whether or not to generate a bottom face, and so on. He also upgraded some of our shaders to support top versus side shading, so we can have some rounded shapes with one material on the top and another on their sides. It's amazing how much this change helped our flow. Add in some organic models to add to level geometry, and suddenly you can look at one of our finished levels and see how one is broken down. Procedural cylinder, spline, spline, bespoke model, spline, cylinder, cylinder. It makes it easy to update level layouts while still sticking to a cohesive style. It's definitely not going to win us any best art direction awards or anything, but at this point we were just happy to have a workflow that felt like we'd actually be able to build levels with.
Good job, buddy! By the time we had conquered all of these issues, it was the beginning of 2023, and all that was left to do was to put all of our shiny new tools to the test. Our gameplay was smooth, and our level design tools were ready for a test drive. We set out to build a vertical slice of the final game, to get the whole team ramped up on the new pipeline, and to make sure we had all of the systems we would need to ship the real game. But what is a vertical slice? Think of each aspect of a game as being a horizontal layer on the giant layer cake that makes up the whole experience. At the bottom, you've got your code and logical systems. Then you've got level geometry. Then you have 3D art. Then visual polish, and so on. For the full game, you, ideally, have all of these layers firing on all cylinders, across the whole thing. However, a vertical slice sees you make a small bit of the actual game content, but have all the layers firing on all cylinders throughout. Essentially, the goal is to demonstrate what the final product might look and feel like for a smaller section of the gameplay.
Our vertical slice needed to showcase four things. One, all four of our base powers, the two duos, and the fully combined power set. Two, the different sorts of levels players can expect in the final game. 3. Charming characters and visuals. 4. A high degree of polish. New tools in hand, we planned out what would ultimately become Slime 64 Slimes of the World. We would frame the whole experience as a museum exhibit that allows visiting slimes to experience the powers of different slimes from around the world. It was a simple framing device that let us contextualize all the different gameplay into a simple hub area that would give us a chance to hone each area's visual identity without having to go super hard on all of it.
The perfect fuel for this part of the project came in the form of an acceptance to a games convention called Too Many Games. We had gone in the past as attendees and were super excited at the idea of getting to showcase our game there. We got the news in February, and the convention was at the end of June. We had around 4 months to get a build ready for the con.
We wanted a way to introduce players to each power, to then test their mastery of the power, before ultimately opening them up to a playground to use that power to explore in. This led to us creating the three-level approach for Earth, Fire, Air, and Water. Each of the single element tracks have two initial trial levels. The first is extremely linear, only has bells to collect, and serves to introduce the different mechanics used by a given power. That level immediately leads into the second trial, which goes more hands-off with telling the player what to do, but requires a decent understanding of the given power to complete. Once these are beaten, the player is returned to the museum, and a new portal has opened, leading to what we call an exploratory level. These are levels much more directly inspired by Banjo-Kazooie. They have bells, whistles, and keys strewn throughout. For each of these exploratory levels, we try to demonstrate different ways to hide whistles, different objectives needed to collect keys, and different levels of NPC and set piece densities. Would players like more straightforward mechanical levels, or more dense ones with varied key objectives and characters to talk to?
From there, we made exploratory levels for the fire and earth combo, a desert level, and the water and air combo, a rainforesty level. We capped it off with a final level that gives the players all four powers.
From there, we added various NPCs to talk to in the museum and throughout the levels, and improved our dialogue system in the process. Did we make it in time for the con? Mostly. That final level was basically a very simple sandbox at the time, but most of the rest of the content was ready to go. One funny thing we learned was that we didn't have time to get a title screen ready, but that ended up being a winning strategy. The fact that the game was literally pick up and play actually reduced the friction behind getting con-goers to try the game.
Over the convention weekend, we had over 300 people play the game, give us great feedback, and overall had a great time with the game. To anyone from Too Many Games who happens to see this, thank you so much for taking the time to try our game out!
We took tons of notes from people playing the game, both based on what they told us and what we were seeing from their playthroughs. Sometimes players will give you a point of feedback by proposing a solution, like, make the player move faster, but really that means levels are too big, or not densely packed enough, or the checkpoints are too spaced out, or something else. I can make a whole video on that, too.
With our notes in hand, we returned home with the aim of shipping the full demo by the end of the summer. It was nearly July, and we figured we had most of the systems we needed, right?
Okay, so we didn't have all the systems we needed. The convention build had no real progression. It tracked all the collectibles you had, but there was nothing stopping you from simply walking to the last level first. We had to build a whole system to unlock levels and to progress through the museum. Then we needed a title screen, a bunch more settings, and a ton of playtesting to make sure the game would run well on different people's machines. Not to mention the laundry list of feedback from the convention itself, and the ever-important polish. But as we approached the end of October, we finally saw the light at the end of the tunnel. We made final preparations, ran a super tiny playtest with a few friends, fixed those bugs, and then finally shipped the demo.
It took some extra doing and assistance from people in our Discord, but we were also able to get the game working on Mac and Linux, most notably, the Steam Deck. So over half a year of work later, and we had finally shipped our vertical slice, showing the world what Slime 64 could be. How did it do?
Pretty good. In the first 2 weeks of the demo releasing, we had around 500 downloads and many more complimentary licenses issued. Can someone explain precisely what this means? Steam's documentation hasn't been super helpful, honestly. The demo has a built-in feedback form, and, as of this video, has over 40 responses, which have been really helpful. General feedback has been varied opinions on the powers, but overall positive, a ton of constructive feedback. Pretty universal agreement that more varied key objectives and denser levels with more characters and things to do are good things to have. And overall, very few folks have complained about technical or performance issues, and most people have been able to find all the settings they could want to change, which was a really big goal for us. Releasing anything into the public, even a demo or vertical slice, is always super daunting. We really appreciate everyone who has taken the time to try out Slime 64 Slimes of the World so far. And if you've made it this far in the video, we'd love it if you'd give it a try too. The Steam link is in the description, and if the game at all interests you, we'd also really appreciate it if you added it to your wishlist. It's sort of like YouTube liking and subscribing, but for Steam's algorithms instead. And I mean while unplugging socials. Actually, no. I've always found standard calls to subscribe too boring. How about this?
All that aside, 4.5 years in, and we've finally released a vertical slice and gotten a ton of great feedback. What's next?
We've proven out our workflow and tested all of our systems on a reasonably wide release across multiple platforms to great success. All that's left now is to actually use all these systems we've built to make the full game. We've been taking an intentional hiatus through the 2023 holiday season after the intense months leading up to the demo's release, and we're going to be part of the MAGFest Indie Video Game Showcase from January 18th through the 21st. If you're near the Washington, D.C. area, or are otherwise coming to MAGFest, we hope you'll come through and try out the game. We're actually working on making a special expo build of the demo that deliberately removes the title screen, automatically resets save data if left idle for too long, and has a few other quality of life features for showcasing the game in a convention setting. After that, the plan is to sit down and have a long pre-production meeting. We've got a general outline of the full structure of the game written out, but we want to make sure any holes in it are filled. From there, we turn the outline into a series of achievable tasks. Level white boxes, cutscenes, character designs and dialogue, and so much more has to be put together. We have so many ideas and we really want to make Slime 64 the best it can be. When'll it be done? We don't know. It really depends on our lives, us sticking to our scope, and how our pipelines hold up.
We'd love to get the final game in people's hands tomorrow, but we're not even sure saying 2024 is realistic at this time. Now that the demo exists, and there's something actually worth playing on Steam, we hope to stay active on social media and bring folks along for the ride as we build a game that's just fun, you know?
So, that's a taste of what it's like to work on a game for multiple years. We left a ton of excruciating detail out, but hope we've given you an insightful look at what the game dev journey looks like for small teams doing what they love and learning as they go. As we've written this video, we've already made notes of multiple other videos we want to make as future devlogs, but what do you want to hear about? We want these devlogs to provide both entertainment and education for players that are fans of these sorts of games and for fellow indie developers.
And finally, what is your favorite 3D platformer? What does it do that other games just haven't nailed yet, even all these years later? Sound off in the comments below.
Make sure to check out Slime 64 on Steam and to try out Slime 64 Slimes of the World, our 2-hour-long vertical slice, for free at the link in the description below. Wishlisting the game on Steam goes a long way towards supporting us, and remember to...